Steve Oesterle is a medical doctor. He's also the senior vice president of medicine and technology. He has a small startup called Medtronic, which he joined in 2002. Before that, he was an associate professor at Harvard and head of invasive cardiology at Mass General Hospital. And is that our colleague from one of the
years? 18 years.
18 years. 4 years.
So Simon asked me to do this in 4 minutes, and I'm going to try to do this in 4 minutes. I'm going to take it from a high-level conversation to a fairly base conversation and give you a specific example of challenges and what we think of in the medical device world as innovation challenges. And perhaps I'll just give you some context for some of the discussions today. I looked through the catalog of people here and realized that most of you are not from the medical field, so I have one slide here that sort of briefly shows you what medical devices are. So you have something made has to these things. This is very different from pharmacology. It's extremely different from biotechnology. These are largely business of one sort or another. Many of them came actually from engineering schools in and around the Bay Area. And they're things as simple as mechanical sending scaffolds that are put into the vascular cure to very sophisticated hybrids. These are kind of different pacemakers for reading particles, large loops from these. Again, much of the technology is coming out of this, although the PC industry, by most parts, actually, in this cluster in the cities. So these are devices, and this, for those of you who don't know what Medtronic is, it is actually business sort of starting to grow at about 12 to 14% a year for the last 20 years. It's a 6-year-old company. We are in about 30 countries, and we treat about 5 million people a year with our devices, so it's a big company. I want to sort of bring up a point that this is largely implant technology, and it's largely for chronic degenerative disease, and this sort of presents what the innovation challenges are. Manuel alluded to this, it's true that we are an aging population. We talk about it in the sense of this somehow cycle of innovation. I would argue, at least in our world, that it's an enormous catalyst. There's going to be a doubling of the population over 60 to 80 countries in the next 25 years. If you're a young child born in Japan, you have a 50% chance of living to be 100. So you can sort of see these numbers. By 2050, we're going to have over 380 million people beyond the age of 80 in the world. Now, the implications of this are staggering in many, many ways, but let me suffice to say, I think there was another event going on in the Twin Cities this week that we can see more about. Talk about taking politicians on the
scrub. Is that about aging population?
Yeah. So the vice president actually candidly believes that in creation, in Chicago schools, and some of you may know about this concept of intelligent design, let me assure you, having been a physician for 25 years, that there is no such thing as intelligent design. And the issue here is that our bodies are not actually designed to last. They're not built to last. And so the system is a local swarm from the baby boom. People moving into their 60s, 70s with things falling apart. And it's a very big issue. So most of what we do in the medical device world is to try to palliate or ameliorate symptoms of chronic degenerative diseases. Now, the implications of this are huge because I think in the United States, most of you are aware of this, and I was interested in that man model where I think it's pretty difficult. So I love your concept of pricing as a patient pressure. It really is in our business, and I could come back and maybe we'll talk about it today, but we have standard margins in the range of 80%. So the pricing pressures for us are actually really interesting in how it actually forces us to innovate to maintain those kinds of margins. But the issue is that right now we spend about 14% of the GDP on healthcare in the United States. It's more than most countries in the world, you know this. These are not our projections, it's not our optimism. The Medicare service actually predicts that by 2016, 20% of the GDP in the United States will be spent on healthcare, $4.1 trillion. So you can look at this in many, many ways. It's opportunities, chaos, it's a crisis, all those things, but it certainly is a patient pressure. This is not sustainable. And so one of the biggest challenges is how can we take money out of the healthcare system through innovation and devices? This is how we lead this. Is that we have this business schedule, this plan of devices. We know that around the world people are innovating things like biologics, so Manuel mentioned biotech will be the next huge revolution. We think it will be actually. So the question is, how do we integrate there's this extraordinary wave of technology, communication technology. I mentioned we have these hybrid implants that have radios and telemetry. We have the ability to do sensing of bodily function. We can remotely monitor through broadband networks, data storage. We have conversations with all the way from Cisco to Qualcomm to Docomo Japan on how we can remotely monitor care for patients. And the question is, how do we integrate that? The whole world of material sciences is sort of integrating nanotechnology, MEMS technology, polymer technology into our devices. The innovation challenge for all of us is that we don't have any knowledge. So here's a company charging along, putting about $900 million free cash flow bank in business. But we sort of see all this innovation going on around us. The question is, how do we integrate this? Where does it happen? We can't do this alone. So the question is, where do we do this? We can't stay in Indianapolis. We can't go to China. We could go to Iowa. And there are places to do this, but it's not in the Twin Cities. The question, probably the biggest challenge for us in this convergence of innovation, is the business models are vastly different. I mean, we operate at 80% standard margins. Some of the people that we're trying to work with operate at 3% standard margins. We have a product cycle time of 24 months, start to finish. We have conversations with Genentech where they want to talk about 15-year product cycle. And so this challenge of innovation for us, I think, is a really desperate one. And I'm going to leave it here just to say that this is a specific example of what we think of as innovation, and you're right. It's a pretty big concept, even in Medtronic. But we know that we can't do it alone, that this sort of world of gizmology was pretty good 6 years ago, over its dead. And so the question is, how do we work with all the people in this room who actually maybe are somewhat agnostic about creationism? But not, it's not intelligent design. We need some technology fixes. I'm really glad that I had a chance to speak with these people. Thank you.